science, the social studies, the art skills, the imagination to solve the problem. Okay, how do you solve that problem? Well, you have to build an outdoor habitat for the bunny rabbit. Well, think of all the little things that kids have to, the second days, have to pull together, the math to make measurements, the science to think about insulation, the art even to make the thing look good if you're going to put it outside. And it all has a different meaning, and they all work together to solve the problem because everybody, of course, wants to build a nice house with the bunny rabbit that's functional, that's safe, and all that. That's engineering for second grade. Okay. So the second argument was engineering offers a wonderful way for project-based instruction and problem-solving and enhances collaborative learning. The third one is it makes math and science relevant. And you all teach at girls' schools, and you know what attracts girls in science is the relevance. And that's why girls get attracted to fields, science fields and engineering fields, where the benefit to society is evident. Medicine, 50% of the medical school students are women. Is it easy to get to medical school? Mm-mm. Look at life sciences. Majority of students are women. Are they easy fields? Oh, no. But it's evident. You work in a pharmaceutical company, you create medicine, you help. Even in engineering, what are the fields that attract women? Environmental engineering, biomedical engineering. Okay, the fields that help the world. Relevance is particularly important for girls, but it's also important for all children. Now, the biggest enemy of the initiative to introduce engineering when we first started were the science teachers, believe it or not. And I went to a meeting with 600 science teachers. And some of you might have been in that meeting and may remember the crazy guy that got up screaming, but I'll tell you the story. So here I am, I'm giving my talk, and in the middle of my talk, like laugh, let's say, this guy gets up and started yelling, and I thought the building was on fire. You know, because he stands in the middle of the talk. So I stopped. I said, "Sir, what's going on?" He said, "How do you dare, with everything that we have on our plate is so full, you want to throw one more thing for us to teach? We cannot even make it to the end of the year with everything we have to teach." So I asked, "What grade do you teach, sir?" He said, "Sixth grade." "And what do you teach?" "Earth science." "And what topic do you teach?" "Volcanoes." "How long have you been teaching volcanoes?" He said, "A month." So I couldn't resist. I said, "So how long did you teach the kids how a car works?" He said, "Oh, this is not science. We don't teach that." I said, "Well, how often do your kids find themselves in a volcano compared to a car?" You can imagine, everybody laughed, you know. By the way, this happened in 1996. I still see this guy in Congress, and he hates my guts. Now, there is nothing wrong with teaching volcanoes. Kids should know about volcanoes, because volcanoes offer a wonderful way to teach plate tectonics and earth structure and all that. But don't tell me you spend a month teaching about volcanoes, and you have no time teaching how a car works. You know? So yes, the curriculum is full, but full of what? Okay? So, you know this relevance thing, math and science? It's at the college level too. We used to have it at Tufts, at the college level. We would accept brilliant engineering students. Tufts is one of the hardest engineering schools to get in the country, okay? We would lose 25% of the kids to liberal arts the first year. When I first became dean, I was shocked, because, you know, as a faculty member, I didn't pay attention to this thing, but when you're in administration, you know. So when I noticed, I went to my predecessor, the previous dean, I said, "Fred, we're losing 25% of the kids." He said, "What's your problem?" I said, "Well," he said, "well, the average school loses 50% of the kids, so we're doing very well." So I did something, and, you know, I looked at the scores of the kids that were dropping out, 1400 verbal class math SAT, the average score, graduated from the top 5% of the high school class, and when they transferred, they had a B+ GPA. So it was not like they couldn't do it. So I couldn't resist, and I asked them. First time anybody had a focus group to ask the kids why they're transferring out. Brilliant move. So I asked them, look what they said. They said that we're transferring out because we don't find engineering interesting. Mm-hmm. What I found interesting is they hadn't taken any engineering at the time they were transferring out. Because what's the freshman year in engineering? Math and science. Okay? So pulled my buddies together. I said, okay, we have to solve the problem. We have to bring some of the best faculty members to teach freshman engineering, but do it in a cool way. And by introducing engineering, not by moving the sophomore course into freshman year, then you would lose 50% of the kids. But let's think on what's a cool way to show them our passion about engineering. And how do you show your passion? You show your passion if you talk about your hobbies and your research. Okay, so let's create freshman level courses that are based on our hobbies and our research. And then how do you convince now tenured faculty members to teach freshmen. Money. That's how you do it. So I got a big grant from the National Science Foundation, so I had lots of money. And everybody was behind the let's make it happen, because graduate students were funded and summer stipends were given. And we created 12 new courses, introductory courses, and now, by the way, there are 60 at Tufts. That stem out of the personal interests and hobbies of the faculty. So I, of course, had to give the good example, so I created two courses, and my two main hobbies is fishing and cooking. So my fishing course was called Life in Moving Fluids, which was fluid mechanics, how gases and liquids move and how solids interact with them, but from the nature's point of view, for the point of view of a fish or a plant. Remember, all living organisms live in a fluid. So fluid mechanics are relevant to a lot of people, and relevant to us when a hurricane hits or a tornado comes. You know, we don't pay attention to that, or we swim or scuba dive. So, but we don't pay much attention. But if you're a fish or a tree, you constantly have to deal with that. So things have evolved and developed to take advantage of all the fluid mechanics. And I loved, actually, a pure example of life-moving fluids. You know the maple samara seeds that look like helicopter blades? And they're all over the ground in the season? This was a perfect fluid, a life-moving fluids case, where the plant has evolved to take advantage of, you know, of fluid mechanics to propagate itself. You know, the seed dislodges, and then because of the helicopter blade. So we used to study all the science of that in the classroom, and the kids were excited. And my course used to be taught right before lunchtime. So after my class was done, hundreds or thousands of kids would actually leave the big engineering building to go to lunch at us. And I could tell from far away, when it was maple samara season, which ones were my students, because all the other kids, you know, they typically would have their iPod, whatever, and they would walk like that, you know, college walk. And my kids would just pick up this maple samara seeds, throw them up in the air, and everybody thought that my students were getting stoned in my class. But it was wonderful to see that they have a totally different perspective than their classmates about nature and engineering. Now, my other course, which was my favorite one, or the cooking course, was called Gourmet Engineering. And it was basically a heat transfer course. Okay, junior level course, boiled down, but you know, brought down to the freshman level. And you know, when you cook, you transfer heat by conduction or convection or radiation or all of the above, depending on your barbecue, your broiling, your baking, your frying. So we would do all the theory in the classroom, and heat transfer is a very mathematical subject. And you know, the whole point is to show them why math is useful or you need math. So a problem we would solve is you have a cylinder, you start at an initial temperature of 70 degrees Fahrenheit, you put it at a different temperature environment at 350 degrees Fahrenheit, how long would it take for this part of the cylinder inside to reach a temperature of 140 degrees Fahrenheit? And you would start solving the problem. You need differential equations to do that, and freshmen don't know that other than some geeks. So then I would sort of solve it for them, and they would see how you need the calculus and the differential equation. And why did they care? Because what followed that, after we calculated with math that how long it would take for the temperature to be 140, we would go to my fabulous kitchen laboratory that Cathalon and Frigidaire donated. I had the most wonderful science cooking laboratory in the country. Actually, we were on the front web page back then of Cathalon. It was my laboratory. That's if you do Cathalon.com, it would be the Tufts Science Laboratory. I had pots and pans in this lab that I could never afford now. So we would go in the lab, and here's the experiment. The cylinder was a roast. And the problem we're trying to solve is a problem that every one of us is thinking about. How long would it take if I take a roast at 70 degrees Fahrenheit, which is a roast sitting out in the kitchen table for a while, and you put it in a 350 oven to roast it, how long would it take for the center to be medium rare, which is 140 degrees? So all of a sudden, the cylinder and temperature, ambient temperature, became a real problem that we need to know the answer. So we put all sorts of thermocouples, wire thermometers, and turn the oven on and see how long it would take. And it would be pretty close to what we found with math. And everybody would be amazed how math can actually be useful, and you can solve real problems with that. And you cannot imagine the stories that after Thanksgiving, the kids went home, you know, that they blinded everybody with science, with the turkey and convection radiation and this and that. Chris Rogers, my buddy, had another course which was very cool, Design and Performance of Musical Instruments, which was an acoustics course, another mechanical engineering topic. And each kid had to design and build a musical instrument. And at the end of every semester, they used to have a concert, and they would invite me at the concert, all their stuff, because I used to let them use the faculty lounge, so I was sort of their guest. And every year, the everything looked wonderful and sounded horrible. Guess, folks, what happened after we introduced these courses? Immediately, TAFS became and still is the only engineering school in the country, probably the world, that more kids transferred into engineering from liberal arts than the other way around. And the best retention was for women and minority students. I have no idea why, but I took full credit for it. So, does engineering take away from math and science? No, it makes them relevant and kids stick with it. And if you're wondering why kids lose interest in middle school, not only girls, but actually minority students or inner city kids, which is sort of what girls lose interest because they go for relevance. And when you go to inner city kids, they all go for relevance because they don't have the parents banging on their head, you know, you should do physics. So it's whatever is relevant, cool, they do, whatever it is not, they don't. And look at the science and the math at the middle school for inner city kids. It's all about the natural world and look at the world around. It has nothing to do with the world around. They don't give a damn about the rainforest. They don't care about things that are around. And they lose interest. But by engineering, you use science and math to solve real stuff that you're passionate about. So this was the third reason, makes math and science relevant. The fourth reason is careers. This is a real problem. We cannot run the United States without engineers, okay? Because everything is touched by an engineer. And here is the real problem. It's not politically correct, and it's a real numbers issue. 72% of the US engineers have had a relative as an engineer. Which means if you don't have somebody at home, an uncle, an aunt, a mother, a father, a grandmother that's an engineer, chances are you're not going to even think about engineering because career guidance about engineering is pretty poor. Okay. Now, and if you look at the popular media that influences also kids, what are the big heroes on TV? Doctors, okay, lawyers, forensic scientists lately. Because kids now think that, you know, if you wear tank tops and a little miniskirt, you can work with hot people and solve crime problems, you know? Because that's what people wear in wars, and you haven't been to war recently. Pull this out. Pull this out. The muscle shirts for the guys and miniskirts for the girls. So nonetheless, that's good, at least kids are considering a science topic, at least for boys. Think of engineering on popular TV. There's only one engineer, national network, evening TV, prime TV. Don't tell me MacGyver because you're really old if you say that. It just helped you now. So, one engineer, anybody knows? Homer Simpson. That's the image of engineering, folks, on US television. He's a nuclear, he's not even an engineer, but as close as you can get, he's a nuclear technician or something like that. Okay. And if you think, okay, the popular TV is stupid, you know, take NASA. And I served on the NASA board, and still I'm on the education committee, so I can badmouth them because I told them many times. When, you know, NASA is the most sophisticated engineering entity in the world. They do unbelievable things. And they hire 15 engineers for one science. So it's an engineering entity. When the rover made it up to Mars, the NASA press release called it a science miracle. 2 years later, when something went wrong with the rover, how did they call it? An engineering error. Okay. So, how do you expect kids to choose engineering if all the messages are like this? Okay, on the janitor's closet says engineering, you know, an engineering error there. You know, science is getting all the credit or for things engineers did and no career guidance. So here's the problem, numbers problem we have. If you look at the engineering community, it's predominantly white. As whites become a smaller and smaller piece of the pie in the United States, and as other minority groups are becoming a bigger piece of the pie, traditionally kids